Tonight on Access TV, it's Gotham Comedy Live. Get ready to laugh with Stephen Scott, Dan Shackey, Mike Merrifield, Gina Yashere. This week's host, Larry Miller. Gotham Comedy Live, all happening right now. Ladies and gentlemen, Larry Miller!
Thank you, and welcome to Gotham Comedy Live. And that cheer was accepted, and I'm grateful. But it was way too much. Let's all agree on one thing, because I don't care where you're from, there are certain things everyone in our country has in common. Here is one, things we've all come to believe. Number one, working out is a waste of time. It is. It's a stupid waste of time. A friend of mine runs marathons. He's always talking about this runner's high. But he has to go 26 miles for it. And that's why I smoke and drink. I get the same feeling from a flight of stairs. I'm saving time everywhere. It is, why do we waste time like that? Here's a little message to every good athlete in the audience here tonight. Every hour you're in the gym working out, I'm in a bar talking to your girlfriend. I may not be strong, but I'm there. Lift that. We, in one generation, have gone so far from any kind of toughness. If you think about it, no matter how old you are here tonight, your parents were twice as tough as you. And their parents were twice as tough as them. And it keeps getting tougher as you go back. My father, three jobs, went to school at night, you know, built a house, served in a war, did all these things. If it gets to the point where I have built none of these things. If I just go to the bank and the dry cleaners, I need a nap. It's awful. What happened to us? Wouldn't we all just... But that's all right. As long as we know, there's no need to be tough. We drive our kids as nuts as we are. If we're spoiled, they're going to be even more spoiled. And that's the way it's got to be. There's, you know, my kids are at the point now where... How do you even discipline them? What are they going to even say to their kids as a threat? You know, when I was your age, we didn't have jetpacks. We drove to school. We had black Escalades, and we were damn glad to have them. Some of my friends couldn't afford the spinning wheels. Still fills me with rage. What have we done to them? Leave them alone. You know what? It gets to a point. I think the craziest thing we've done to them, I think that the greatest source of meanness we have is Little League. Now, if it gets to a point when it comes to Little League, now you may say, well, Larry, wait a minute. Isn't Little League all about the kids and sunny days and friendships that will last a lifetime? Well, yes, but only in the sense that prostitution is all about working outdoors and being a people person. It's not about the kids. it's about their unmedicated parents. The parents are crazy. Everything in Little League is so tense and so angry. It gets to a point. I'm not afraid of terrorists in the United States because I think Little League mothers will protect us. It's so tough. I think we could have an actual contest, get all the terrorists together in the world, and they could say, you see, we've got millions of young men who'll kill themselves. And we could say, well, that's pretty tough. But you see, over here, we've got 240 women from Sherman Oaks who've just been told their sons didn't make All-Stars. Over to you. Hi. We put too much pressure on these goofy things. That's why we get athletes into trouble and they get themselves into trouble. There's so much pressure. And, in a stupid way, they're trying to sell more space in baseball parks. I understand that. That's fine. But the seats now get closer to the field. You know, so now we've... foul balls go into these stands like rockets. And the announcer always says, now there's a lucky fan. Oh? Really? You ever catch a baseball at 1,000 miles an hour? With your face? Sure is lucky. Boy, they don't tell you when the ball came in, you know. This guy was reaching for a hot dog. That's one with mustard, please. And, well, my eye, it hit my eye. Boy, am I lucky. What a fantastic, good moment that was for me. Well, you know what, by the way? Let it go. There are certain things in your life you should not be doing after a certain age, okay? If you're over 30 and still lean out car windows going, woo! You're an idiot. You should be slapped and sterilized so that this will never occur again. I believe I'm strict but fair. If you're over 30 and still think, yeah, I could turn pro. You're a moron. Let go. I was watching TV with my wife, and the ad came on for that eHarmony, the dating service, where they say they match you up on 29 levels of compatibility. And I turned to her and said, I don't think we have any. And she said, any what? And I said, the 29 levels of compatibility. And she said, yes, we do. I said, no, we don't. And she said, we have all of them. And I got out the dictionary to look up. I looked up compatibility. It says, capable of living together harmoniously or getting along well together. And she said, oh, my God, we don't have that. I said, that's the point. That's good. Marriage has nothing to do with compatibility, okay? First time you can't make a house payment, it doesn't matter that you both like red. She's at that point, and I love her, but she's so much tougher than I am. She's a very aggressive driver. She drives like she's running moonshine. And she hates the way I drive. She's always saying, you know, don't jerk the pedal. You're jerking the pedal. You jerk the car when you jerk the pedal. Don't jerk the pedal. Wait, go around him. Go around him. Go around him. Not him. Turn here, not here, here, not him, him. Don't jerk the pedal, go around him, turn here, and don't let her in. Why did you let her in? Men like you always let women like that in. Thank you.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Stephen Scott is taking the stage when we return. Welcome back to the Access TV presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs happening right now.
There is nothing better than comedy. Comedy is a great form of entertainment, and it's very American. We've made it. And now we're bringing on our first performer of the night, who is someone you've seen all over television on every stage from Broadway to Las Vegas. Please welcome Stephen Scott.
My goodness, that is some serious energy. Wow, seriously, if I could bottle that, I could quit taking amphetamines. I think that would be, no. I'm kidding, I would never stop that. But I'm glad you have energy. I need it this week so bad because I'm exhausted. I haven't been sleeping this week because they just started renovating my apartment building, which has been a nightmare because they have these guys coming in doing construction 8 o'clock every morning. Now, I'm a comedian, so 8 a.m. comic standard time is like, what, 5 a.m. your time? So all week, I haven't needed an alarm clock or wake-up call. Every day, like it or not, I've been waking up to this. Oh, man. Four seizures I had from that this week. Not to mention, when they were doing the construction, they accidentally drilled into the cable line. They knocked the cable out for my whole building. See, you don't realize what hard it is not having cable in today's day and age. It's everything now, right? It's the phone, it's the internet, it's the good channels. Like Access TV. Shameless plug, there we go. But seriously, going a whole week in my place without cable, I feel like I'm one horse and buggy away from being legally Amish. But I find it interesting how people have very different noise tolerances for stuff, usually based on where they're from. Like New York City people have a very high noise tolerance. My buddy was teasing me when I was complaining about the construction. He lives in the city, he's in Manhattan, but he's uptown, like way uptown, like near Vermont. And so, ooh, you guys are taking geography, that's great. He lives on the second floor of one of those buildings like we have in the city where it's right in front of where they got the elevated subway tracks going by. And I'm like, how do people live there? Like, I'm whining to you about construction in my place for, what, 5-6 days? His place? We're talking like every 5-6 minutes. You know, you can't even, you got an 8-train barrel in front of your place. You can't even have a conversation. It's like, hey, dude, what's up? Not much, man. It's funny, though. I just got back from the... I'm like, dude, I'm like, how do you boo-doo? Seriously, can we fix that? 2014, we got robots on Mars, we're cloning sheep. Can we fix the PA on the subway is all I'm saying. No, seriously, we need to get our technological priorities together in our country. We're always building new stuff. Let's fix the old stuff first. How is it possible? 45 years ago, actually this summer, we just had the anniversary. 45 years ago, we had the technology. Back then, we were putting dudes up on the moon. Now, think about this for a moment. The moon is 250,000 miles away and in the middle of outer space. Yet somehow everyone on Earth had no problem hearing this man say,
that's one small step for man.
But somehow to this day on planet Earth, not even what, 2 feet? From any drive-through, it's still... How's that one possible? Anybody? Can we... Yeah. Could we maybe get the lovely folks at Apple to do something about that? There's... Speaking of which, yeah, the you know what we really need to do fix technology-wise are the cell phones. Those have been out a while. They need to work now, don't you think? I was just talking to my dad tonight. He called me earlier. He called me from his cell, and I hate when my dad calls me from his cell because, well, it's embarrassing having a dad in prison. And so I just want to make sure you're paying attention. Okay. Now, I hate when he calls me from the cell phone because he's in the city. He's always in his car. And my dad's one of those guys. He'll call you from the car, and then he spends half the conversation yelling at traffic while you talk to him on the phone. Every chat with him is like, hey, Dad, what's up? Yeah, stay in the car. Just got to work. I was wondering if you... Screw you! Dad, not you. This cab just cut me off. Did you see that son of a bitch? Oh, yeah. I love when he asks me that brilliant question. Did you see that son of a bitch? Yeah, no, I didn't, Dad. But I think I have to go change my underwear now. Thank you very much. I told him he's not allowed to call me from the car anymore. In fact, I told him he's also not allowed to leave me messages from the car. That's just as bad. Because what I'm saying, in New York, with the buildings, the signal cuts, he wonders why I don't return like half of his calls, because he keeps leaving messages on my voicemail like this. Bit. Yeah, Steve, it's your father here. I'm in the car. Just got to work. I've been later tonight. So I was wondering if up at 8:30 would be great. So can you give me a call? I'll be at 212. Ours. My dad's a character. My dad. The reason my dad talks that way is, well, he doesn't talk that way. That'd be weird. Like, hey, Steven, up and later. That'd be creepy. Ooh, did I just do jazz hands on a comedy show? Let's just keep that between us and the millions of people at home. No, the reason my dad talks that way, my dad's a newscaster, so he's got that really deep, loud, authoritative broadcaster voice, which on TV is great, but in public, unnecessary. And the worst is when you're a little kid and you're growing up and you get in trouble and you gotta get yelled at or scolded by someone who talks like that, it puts the fear of God into you. Oh yeah, especially with my dad, who, by the way, was like king of the scolders. I had one of these dads, I think half the time he was inventing stuff to scold us about, because some of it didn't even make sense. He actually once said this to me, he goes, hey, knock it off. You know, when I was your age, I was a lot older than you. Ma, I think Dad's been drinking. But the worst, though, is if ever I was so bad that my mom would have to go and like call him up at work. You know when moms finally are fed up, they've had, that's it, I'm calling your father. That was the worst, because he was already in that newscaster frame of mind. So whenever I'd get yelled at, I always felt like I was a breaking story. Oh yeah, he'd pick up the phone in that newscaster cadence, he didn't play. Like, ah, it's your father. Ah, your mother just told me what you did. Well, I'll tell you something, mister, you're in a lot of trouble. And you're gonna get it when I get home, tonight, at 11. My mom is funny too with the messages. Her problem is the opposite. My mom will call you up. You know, if somebody has a story to tell you, they'll call you up on your machine and they'll say, hey dude, I got a funny story for you, call me back, and then you call them back and they tell you the story. My mom just leaves the entire story on the answering machine. And it's not even important stuff. It's like where she went shopping that day, medical updates from distant family members I hadn't even seen since I'm 8, you know? So I basically got a brand new phone number just for my parents to leave me their crazy messages. And I have a good old-fashioned answering machine to go with it, with the button. So now when I'm home and they call, I listen to their messages like this. Beep.
Hi, sweetie, it's your mother. Remember me? I'm the woman who gave birth to you. It's been 3 days and I would like to know that you're still alive. Look at me, I'm sitting here and I am reading through the obituary column. And I am not seeing your name anyplace. So I'm expecting a call. Love you. Beep.
Yeah, Steve, it's your father here. I'm in the car. Your mother's calling. Up at where you are. So, up oars.
Beep. Hi, sweetie. Guess who?
I love guess who. Like, I have no idea whose voice.
Sweetie, it's mom. Where are you? Wait a lunch next weekend. Because it's your sister's birthday. And everyone's coming over, and we're shopping yesterday, and I bought the most beautiful 30% off. I couldn't believe it. And the woman with him, because Aunt Sylvia's stool sample came back from the lab. I don't know, the doc when I was 9.
No more memory. That's it for me, guys. You've been awesome. Enjoy the show. Good night.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Dan Shacky is taking the stage when we return.
Our next performer is a great comic, and tonight is an exciting show for him because it's his first time on television. Please welcome Dan Shacky.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I've been going to the beach a lot this summer. I was at the beach, and these girls asked me if I could take their picture. I already did. How about you give me your phone number, and I'll text it to you. Just looking for love. My ex-girlfriend, she used to always try to test my love. She would ask me questions like if I would take a bullet for her. That is a ridiculous question. Most murders are committed by somebody we know. So I would like to take that bullet, but statistically speaking, I'm gonna be the one pulling the trigger. What love's all about. I live here in New York City. I live in Astoria, Queens. Got some neighbors. It's kind of a weird neighborhood. I had to call for a cab to the airport, and I said, hey, can I get a taxi to LaGuardia at noon tomorrow? And the guy goes, okay, bye. Hey, maybe don't hang up the phone just yet. Aren't you supposed to ask me for my address? Or tell me what this is going to cost? Or, I don't know, do anything at all to convince me a transaction has just been made over the telephone? Here's the weirdest part. He showed up. Mentally, I am an adult male. I have it together. But emotionally, I am still just a teenage girl. There's a huge mess inside. I will give you an example. I am heterosexual, but a friend of mine told me this gay guy we know said I was hot, and I had like a million follow-up questions. Let me get this straight. Did he say I was hot, or did he say I was cute, or did he say I was boyfriend material? What were his exact words? Am I blushing? I feel like I'm blushing a little bit. Some guys, they're really homophobic. If they heard that, they wouldn't go near him. But that guy made my month. I'm getting my life together because of him. If I'm going somewhere and I think he's gonna be there, I'm not gonna do anything with him when I see him, but I definitely think about what I'm wearing before I leave the house. That guy believes in me. I'm not gonna let him down. Okay. I guess you guys believe in me too. All right. I haven't joined a gym because of this. I'm in my 30s, so my options are either join a gym or get married. And the gym at least lets me go month to month. You high-fived on that. You were gonna get married, and then instead you were like, let's just join a gym. Family pass. I never thought I would join a gym. In high school gym class, we did a weightlifting unit, and I would just sit around and not do it. And one day the gym teacher pulled me aside and he said, Dan, when you're an adult, you're gonna pay your hard-earned money to join a gym and lift weights. So you should really take advantage now. And I had no idea that the guy who wore sweatpants to work was gonna be 100% right. When I signed up, they told me I get a free body fat analysis and fitness test. And they asked me if I want to do that in a group or one-on-one. Who's choosing to do a body fat analysis in a group? Most people wouldn't do it alone with a mirror in the room. Fitness test, that's a big scam. They just want you to hire them to be your personal trainer. And if I'm going to pay someone to pretend to be interested in my body, it's not going to be this guy named Steve. I already got a guy interested for free. I really just joined the gym because I went through a bad breakup and I thought it would be a good distraction. And I had no idea the trainer was gonna ask all these personal questions. He asked me, Dan, what are your goals? I don't know, revenge? I can't really relate to anybody at the gym. There's this guy I see there, and he's lifting weights every day, but he has a mullet. How do you care so much about how you look, but care so little about how you look? I just want to be healthier. Those are my goals, to be healthier. I went to see my doctor. My doctor asked a lot of mental health questions. So he asked me if I have any suicidal or homicidal thoughts. So I said, only while I'm driving. And then I have homicidal thoughts towards a lot of the other drivers, usually a couple of pedestrians. Is that a problem? And he said, well, that depends. Do you plan it out? Well, based on how you're asking me, I'm gonna say no. And then I saw him write something down. And I thought, oh, why'd you have to write something down? Now I have to kill you, too. Big pro-murder crowd, all right. But you understand, driving makes you very aggressive. Sometimes I'll pull up to a red light and the car behind me will pull, not even into a lane, just into the empty parking spaces next to me. And I start losing my mind. I start thinking, there's no way this guy is getting ahead of me when that light changes. He is not better than me. And then the light turns green, and I speed off. And he makes a right turn. And then I realize that guy is way better than me because he is not involved in an imaginary competition. Just my insecurities. I'm insecure about things. As I get older, I'm getting better at pinpointing my insecurities. I have a crooked spine and I have crooked teeth, but I was blessed with 20/20 vision, so I could see all my imperfections just in perfect high definition. Decided to fix my teeth, though. I got those invisible adult braces. I had them for a year and a half. Problem is, people would always notice them. So they're not so invisible that you can't see them. They're just invisible enough that people would ask, hey, what's going on with your mouth? A Also not sure if they count as adult braces when my mother was paying for them. But that is the title. Sounds better than big boy braces. Worst part is I've learned looks, they're not that important in life. Here's how I found up. I told you I joined this gym. I slimmed down a lot from it. And you learn a lot about yourself when you get into shape. I learned the reason I hadn't been getting laid was my personality. Thank you guys so much.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Mike Merrifield is taking the stage when we return. Welcome back to the Access TV presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs right now.
Our next performer was just seen at the MGM Hotel in Las Vegas. Please welcome Mike Merrifield.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm on television. Right? Bring on that TV pussy. Come on.
All right. Too far? All right. This is good. I actually am single. I went through a divorce or whatever, and good timing on my ex-wife's part, because I'm 42, I'm bald, I'm almost completely unfuckable. Really came in under the wire. Laughed a little too hard at that one. Hey, it's, you know what's, the worst part about being 42 and having a date again is I gotta compete with all you young pricks or whatever. Like, I gotta have, and you gotta have dick pics on your phone or whatever. You gotta have, I mean, I guess, I thought that's how it worked. Like, I met this girl, she gave me her number, so I immediately sent her a picture of my dick. That's what you're supposed to do. But like a new one, a fresh one. Right? I'm trying to be romantic. I want to make it special. I wrote her name on there. First and last. That's a tough thing, taking a picture of your junk, man. I mean, when you're 18, purple shirt, you, how old are you? 28. I mean, you got a boner right now. That's how ready your dick is. I'm 42, I got to prep that shit. I'm running a good 20% on a good day, right? I went from the bottom up when I took the photos. That's how I went. Shut up. You can throw in a couple extra inches of sack and nobody knows the difference, right? You just got to be careful you're not in the picture. That's the tough part. When you're doing that one, you're like, oh, you know? And don't have anything in the photo that shows scale, all right? You don't want like a Red Bull can in your hand. You know what I mean? At my age, it's all about angles and shadowing. I would hate to be a woman, though. I don't know how you guys take pictures of your stupid genitals. You can't even see them. You have to just blindly try to capture. You got to turn the screen around on your phone and just fucking brrr, you know? Thank God the iPhone has that new burst technology, right? You can brrr, you know? I am nothing but butthole today. I don't know what is happening. I am all taint this afternoon. I don't know what's happening with my... I will say this, though. I've been dating, and as far as I can tell, younger women are into a lot freakier shit than I remember. Right? Like, first date kind of stuff that you would normally wait, like, 10 years. Like, you would pretend you were in love with her, and then you'd bring it up some night when you're drunk, like, oh, can we put it in your butt, you know? And, right? But now it's like second date. You can put it in my butt if you want. And you're like, what the? That seems like a trap. That seems... How bad is your vagina? How bad is your vagina when you're like, you just might want to start around back there. You just might want to... No, that's all bad news bears down there. You're going to want to go around back for a little bit. I think what it is I think women see more pornography now. Like, that used to be a man's game, you know? And by the way, fuck you for getting it for free, all right? You bastard. I had to lurk into a porn shop at 3 a.m, all hammered, trying to act like I'm buying it for a bachelor party. Oh, let me grab a couple of those butt porns for this bachelor party, you know? Throw in some of those butt plugs, too. That'll get a laugh, you know? There's no bachelor party. You're putting those butt plugs in your own ass. That's what's happening. And then you have to own it. That's the thing. You have to go in and buy it. Then you have to own it. You have to shuffle around a box of shame around your house full of pornography. You don't have to deal with that. None of you do. That's why you're all quiet right now. You're like, what? You had to buy it? Yeah, and you had to hide it from your loved ones. And then you had to get rid of it, which isn't easy. You can't throw it in your garbage. You got to take that to like a school or something, or like a, right? I mean, you want to get a laugh if you're going to get rid of it. But not you. You just whack off to the weirdest shit. Probably 24/7 based on how you look. Probably a lot. And then all you do is, oh, delete the browser history. Ha ha. Fucking one button and you're not a creep. Do you understand what I had to go through to hide what a pervert I am? You just go, oh, guess who's not a weirdo? This guy, you know. Guess who didn't just spend 2 hours questioning his sexuality? This guy here. What kind of sites are you into, man? What are your favorite sites for porn? All of them? Fuck. Does your dick look like a hamburger right now? Jesus, man. I'm an ex-hamster guy. I love the ex-hamster. You ever go there? Oh, it's good. Oh, you never heard of it? You get it, though, right? Hamster? Because vaginas used to look like hamsters back in the day. Not anymore, thank God. I want to kiss the man who invented the Brazilian right on the mouth. That is a good man. Get it back to the way that God intended it, right? I think hair is more of an environmental thing. And you can't go back. I'm sorry. You can't go back from a Brazilian. You cannot go backwards. Once you experience it, you can't go back. It's like going from an iPhone back to a phone with a cord. Like a hairy, fucking matted, sometimes doesn't smell the best cord. That's what I'm trying to say. See, and you don't even know what I'm talking about. Vaginas used to be hairy. Do you know that? Have you ever watched the vintage porn? It used to be just down there. You had to factor in extra time to get through the hair to the vagina back in the day. By the way, I notice how weird the women are getting in here. I can actually hear your vaginas right now. What the fuck is he talking about? Oh my God. We're vaginas. You're not allowed to talk about us like that. Yes, that's my impression of your vagina. I make no apologies. Actually, I'm working on it. I don't know if it should be this or that. Like, I haven't figured out. I know I got the voice right, though, right? Yeah. I'm a vagina. Yeah. Maybe a little more hair lip, a little more, I'm a vagina. It's a balancing act. That's all I'm saying. I'm a father. I got 2 kids, you know? I mean, I gotta have dick pics on my phone, but they like to play Angry Birds, so it's a balancing act, you know? We're at the park the other day, and my 7-year-old's on the monkey bars. He's kicking ass. He goes, Dad, take a photo. And I pull my phone out, but it was full, because I had a big photo shoot the night before. And I hadn't gone through the proofs yet and picked my favorites. And I thought I was gonna be doing that at home, but I guess right here in the park, nothing fucking creepy about that. Let me just, if you need me, I'll be over by the teeter-totters thumbing through some dick pics. I wish I had a vagina, right? I mean, I don't think I'd be a responsible vagina owner if I had one. I don't think I'd ever stop putting shit in there. That's just me. I would just never... Even if I wasn't putting stuff in, it'd be eyeing things up, going, I'm getting that vagina, you know what I'm saying? Like, I have a lot of confidence. That's just men, that's what we do. We already have who has the bigger dick contest, right? Where we get our dicks out, we get them hard, then we walk towards each other until one guy touches the other guy with his dick. And that's how you measure length. Girth, of course, you lower your erect penis into a bucket of water and you measure the amount of displacement. And I don't think it'd be any different if we had vaginas. I think we'd have capacity contests. I guarantee you, All right, guys, Rick's got the record last week. He got 9 cucumbers in there, everybody. We're gonna see. Should be getting out of the hospital any day now. Thank you guys very much. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Gina Yashere is taking the stage when we return. Welcome back to the Access TV presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs happening right now.
Our next performer has been on The Tonight Show, and she's very proud of that. Please welcome Gina Yashere.
Yay! What's happening, New York? It's good to be here, good to be here. I'm from England, that's why I speak like this. Some of you are looking a little bit confused. Can see your little faces, you're like, is that the butler from Fresh Prince? No, I'm black and British, yes! And I've just moved to New York 2 months ago. Just moved it, yay! I love it, it's great. Who knew that I'd fall in love with the smell of piss and garbage in the summer? New York smells like shit! But I love it. I got chased by a cockroach yesterday. I was walking down the street and this cockroach came out of the drain and I was like, ah! And the cockroach was like, oh, what, bitch? And then chased me. But I like it. I've been in America a few years. I like America. America! Fuck yeah! Fuck America. That's how you sound to me, Americans. I don't know if you know that. Whenever you guys speak, I can't tell the difference between all the different American accents. The only one I do recognize is the Southern American accent, because I hear that accent, I go, ah, that's the kill black people accent. You know, get the fuck out. But all the other accents, I don't know. So whenever you guys speak, all I'm hearing is that song in my head. America, fuck it. That should be your national anthem, Americans. How much more interesting would the Olympics have been if your athletes got up on the podium and just went, America? But I like it. I've been living here a while. I've learned a lot since I moved here. I've learned a lot about Americans. I've been studying you people. What have I learned? In America, when you guys get fat, you get really fucking fat. Like humongous. Like cartoon fat. Like. You guys have taken fat to another level. I saw a guy get cut out of his house. Cut out of your house fat. Surely you'd only just get fat enough so you can get out the door to get more food. Super fat. It's not your fault, Americans. I watch all your commercials. Every commercial is food. Get this great big burger with extra beef and cheese and chicken and steak and bacon and cheese and beef and chicken and steak and bacon and cheese and beef and chicken. All on a sesame seed bun. Subway's trying to pass itself off as healthy. Subway's not healthy, people. I'm gonna have some water. Is that your sorry? Thank you. Subway's not healthy. Throwing a piece of lettuce at a pork chop is not a salad. Because they got that $5, what's that commercial? $5 foot long. This is why you're so fat, Americans. This is the only country in the world that measures its food in feet. Who does that? Who measures their food in distances? You don't walk into a restaurant and go, hello, I'll have a mile of spaghetti, please. Miracle. Thank you. I like America. I've been living here a while now. I've got health insurance now. I'm excited. Which is great, because I just recently got diagnosed with sleep apnea. Yeah, don't woo that. You obviously don't know what the hell sleep apnea is. For one, it's a fat disease. Fat people normally get sleep apnea. Now, I used to be fat, I lost the weight. But they don't tell you, you lose the weight, you can still get fat diseases. I feel cheated, people. I feel cheated. Right? If I'd known I'd still get fat diseases, I would have stayed fat. I like being fat. I enjoyed eating lamb chops for breakfast, lunch, dinner, and snacks. And for those of you that don't know what sleep apnea is, basically, when I'm asleep, your throat is kind of collapsing in on itself, and your airways are getting smaller and smaller, and you keep waking up all night. Basically, my neck is trying to fucking kill me while I'm asleep. Basically. So you never get a good night's sleep because you're always suffocating and waking up to 50 times a night. And if it doesn't get treated, it leads to all kinds of things like heart attacks, strokes, diabetes, death, and snoring. Yeah, I said snoring after death because in my opinion, snoring is worse than death. It's not sexy for a woman to snore, right? Guys can get away with snoring. Women, listen, I'm a woman. I always thought that I slept cute. Every woman in here thinks they look cute when they're sleeping. Not all of us do. I found out on vacation with my friends when one of the bitches filmed me. And it wasn't sexy. I was like that. And then I stopped breathing. It's not sexy. All my friends look cute when they're sleeping. All my friends look great when they're sleeping. They're all like, night, night. They all look like they're having their labias tickled with a feather. And you know what the treatment is? Do you know what the treatment is for sleep apnea? A box. A box that plugs into the wall, that pulls air down this vacuum cleaner pipe thing that ends in a mask. A mask that goes over my face. Like, I've got to sleep with this shit on my face. And what I'm trying to say, people, is I'm never going to fuck again. That's what I'm trying to say. This shit isn't sexy. Is this sexy? Nobody wants to fuck Bane from Batman. What kind of sexual fantasies can I play with that? Just imagine we're in a plane crash. Not sexy. But I'm a comedian, I make light of it. I travel a lot as a comedian, I do. I like to travel, I've been all over the world. I've done some shows in some crazy places. I went to China recently, I did shows in China. Any Chinese people in? Good, let's talk about them. Fuck me. I have never been coughed on and spat on so much in my entire life. I'm sure some of you have been to Chinatown, you know what I'm talking about. Chinese people cough and they don't close their mouths, they don't care that. Bwah! And it's like they pull up the phlegm from the bottom of their feet. Bwah! And they cough on you, you look at them and they look at you like, bitch, we're in China. I got coughed on and spat on a lot. It's okay though, it's okay, it's fine. Because Chinese people, mainly, they're quite small in China, so only got coughed on in the vagina area, so it wasn't as bad. No black people in China, no black people. I got followed and stared at everywhere I went in China. Like, everywhere. Chinese people, they don't give a damn. If they're surprised, they'll let you know they're surprised. I'd walk into a restaurant in Beijing and 300 sets of chopsticks would stop at the same time. I a Chinese woman following me down the street, filming me with her cell phone, just doing this. I'm like, I can see you, bitch. I see you. You're not a ninja. I can see you. Hole in the floor toilets. You know about this? Hole in the floor toilets. Holes in the floor. Holes. Now, this is China. They make everything we produce nowadays. They make everything we use, right? I know they can build a proper toilet. I've used those holes in the floor toilets in China, and they're surrounded by ceramic. So they obviously have the materials. They're just messing with us. So you got to squat a name. You got to squat a name. You got to squat. You got to squat a name. You got to squat an aim over the hole. You got to squat a name. I found out in China that my aim is off. What happened? I was peeing, and I farted while I was peeing. Now, every woman knows what happens, but maybe some guys, you don't know. What happens? What happens? If you fart while you're peeing, it throws off the trajectory of the pee. That's science, sir. That's science. Science. So I pee, I fart, knocks off the pier at a 47.3 degree angle. Basically, what happened, I ended up pissing on the woman in the next stall. She was very upset with me. She came out and shouted at me in Mandarin, and then she coughed on my vagina. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City.
Good night.